very quick. Welcome to the second day of the Blender Conference. We will try in this room to stick to a nice... to a nice fast schedule of the 30-minute talks. I would like to remind everybody to a couple of things which is interesting to know for the conference, like have your badge visible, please. This is the area, including the corridor, where only people who have a badge have access. That means you can leave your clothes or bags here. Don't leave laptops hanging around in this building. You never know what happens with it. There's a mobile app at the Blender.org conference URL. We also have printed schedules. There's a little errors in the schedule. Today's talk, one missing talk in the afternoon. I forgot which one it is. But you can look at the screens, and there will be a screen here with the actual schedule. There's lunch. This is in the foyer, we call it, downstairs and upstairs. It starts at 12, and people can get sandwiches and other stuff to eat. For speakers, we have three volunteers, which is Olivier, he's not in that, Thomas, there is Thomas, and there is Piotr. Yeah. Piotr is doing this morning here, and Thomas is doing this salon. Okay, good, excellent. So there is, for people who have a evening talk for 5 minute open podium, open stage presentation tonight, you also have to talk to Olivier, who will be coming in at some moment. Talk to me and I will point you at who Olivier is. Olivier can help you getting files copied or getting ready for the presentation tonight. This was the slide from yesterday. There's no screening tonight. So after the open presentations at about 7:45, we have the Susanna Award ceremony. People can still vote. Put your voting forms in the box at the desk in the cafe. And then we have dinner tonight. We'll start at about 8 o'clock. Everybody who had a dinner reservation, you should have a ticket in your envelope and 3 drinking coupons. The drinking coupons will be valid after 8 o'clock tonight. So that's it. Have fun. And I will give you to the speaker. Then you can set it to 1280 maximum. If you there's not quite as, is this fine for you, this? You have to put it to mirror. The arrangement, mirror display. That's easier.
Then you
put it to 1280.
Otherwise my projection, otherwise my presentation is probably not going to work.
But the other screen is very small. So you can put this to 1280 here.
Well, I have a keynote presentation, so it's going to be widescreen. So it should work, yeah, actually, with the...
The projector system is really crappy. Okay. So you can only do this if you hold out. Yeah. I think this is a trick. This is widescreen, but everything is fine. Yeah. You see? Now you have white screen?
Yeah, great. That's cool.
But that's all you can get. Huh?
Okay. Thank you. But if I do mirror display, that's not gonna work. If I'm gonna make this a separate display, that's not gonna work.
You could try, but that's very difficult. It's easier to have white screen. You could try, but I don't know. You have to set both screens separately. You want to have separate screens?
That would be great, because then this whole presentation software is going to work.
I have
or I mean, if it doesn't, then I'm gonna just improvise. But yeah, it should, but it projects to a second screen and it gives my my notes on my.
Now you have this.
Oh, that's great. That's great. That's great.
And you go to the left.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks a lot.
Gentlemen.
Yep. So, good morning, everyone, and good morning, everyone. Welcome to this talk about video mapping. You might know what video mapping is all about, and if not, then I hope you will by the end of the talk. First, I'm going to introduce myself shortly, and then afterwards I'll show you some different mappings, different projection mappings I have worked on, and kind of show you how they were done. So there's also a part which is more interesting for people who are totally not into video mapping. So if you're not interested, then be sure to come back by the middle of this talk. So I'm Simon. I studied game design. I do a lot of 3D work in experimental field. This is me trying to look older by projecting wrinkles and a pink mustache onto my face. It's done with a Kinect tracking and kind of real-time mapping the projection onto a face, onto any face actually, without markers, that is in the field of view. This was very experimental. It's really laggy and it's unstable, so I dropped the project in the end because it didn't really work. I'm not sure if it might work with newer Kinect sensors or newer other depth sensors, but the way I had the setup there, it didn't really work. It was still fun to do, though. I started kind of during my game design studies. I have worked at a lab where we had this cave set up. So I've done my first 3D job was actually in a cave environment, and this was also kind of my first projection job. So this was all about virtual reality, and it was great to work there, but the thing I didn't like is that in a cave environment, you can only always get the perspective right from one single point of view. So this projection here on the lower right, for example, it works fine for the person standing inside this cave, but it doesn't from the point of the camera. You can see the great distortion of the line here in the outside, so it's never going to work for more than one person. And also, I really like to do games and entertainment more than research. So I was really happy to meet some people who do facade projections onto buildings. They did a lot of projections onto buildings for shows and stuff like this, and they didn't do anything interactive, but they wanted to get interactive. So together, kind of, we managed to do this augmented reality game, you could call it probably, where you could interact with this projection via iPhone or any phones, actually just any colored light source. So we had a mobile website where you could select a web page with either red or green or blue color, and then wave with this colored light and make the vine grow with a green light, and make feed it with pollen with a blue light, and destroy it by burning it with a red light. This was a lot of fun, and I think you could even consider it a game, because there started to build up groups, and these groups of people who try to build a nice vine, and then there's always some evil guy who comes along and switches his phone to red and burns it all down. So that was great fun, and we got a lot of good responses for this projection. So the guys, this company Projectil, they got their next job, which was much more serious. It was a projection onto an architectural model, which was about 3 or 4 meters wide. It was 1 to 200 in scale. And they actually hired me as a freelancer to help them build this projection. We did it all in Blender, of course, and sorry, that was too loud, excuse me. So this projection worked by actually we had the thing in the real architectural model in 3D as well, and rendered movies from this model from five perspectives where the projectors were, and then played these movies from the view, from the projector's view. This worked really nicely, but it was a really complicated pipeline. Well, not complicated, but it just required a lot of patience. Every time we wanted to test something, every time we kind of wanted to see how this virtual light looks on our architectural model, we had to render five movies and distribute these to these five computers and play them from there. And also there was a projection mapping which was done in post-processing by... So it was quite complicated, and the process of testing something was just too long. So that's when I thought, oh, okay, well, it would be really nice to actually have the whole thing from a 3D viewport, so that you could actually manipulate your scene and see the projection in real time. And it turns out that wasn't really too hard to do. But first, I'd like to hear some effects that I find work with projection mapping for projections that you can walk around. Like this one you've seen now. So all these effects have to work from any point of view. So because you cannot use specular material or glossy material, because it's going to look wrong if you're looking at it from the other side of the room, because it's going to be rendered from a different perspective. Things that really work well was lights and shadows, of course, on diffuse material. I also had really great experience with Boyd's particles in Blender and making them stick to the surface, kind of look like ants crawling around the projection or this thing. Also dynamic paint effects and animated objects that stay close to the projection. So after this project, some choreographer approached me and asked me, well, can you do a piece? She wanted to do a piece where there was no dancers on her scene, on her set, but just the shadows of these dancers. So well, it sounded like a challenge. So we started testing this. We started testing with stock mocap data
and in a really simple room. So you can see this this room is just square room, really, really easy to map. And the mapping was done all from live from the 3D viewport. So I kind of made a second. I duplicated a Blender window and made the 3D viewport all fill out the whole thing, and just played with these settings. And this is quite easy to do. You just model the room by measuring and modeling. Actually, I'm not sure if it could be, probably could be done by more sophisticated 3D scene reconstruction things, but I haven't got into this yet. So what I did was just measuring and modeling like this, and then just set the camera resolution to the projector resolution, of course. Also, make sure to note to check the specification of your projector for the field of view, so you can set the field of view of the camera to the same value. And then this checkbox lock camera to view is really handy, because then you can slide your full screen 3D window onto the projector, make it full screen, and it's still going to stick, the borders are going to stick there, and you're going to be set up all fine. Then you can hide the side panels and the footers and all that, and you actually have this. And now you're going to be able to just adjust these vertices so that the wireframe fits just fine with the borders or the edges of the room. And once you've done that, you can start playing around with spotlights, and that looks almost like, or if you do it right, actually, it looks like there's real spotlights in the room. And if by any chance there's a light designer which is used to kind of climbing light rigs to change his light setups, then he's probably going to be quite impressed. That's what happened to me. It was a really cool experience to actually see some light designer being impressed by virtual light which was mapped into a room. One thing to be aware of when working with virtual lights in a real setup is that the projector, the light from the projector, also has a light fall off, like a real light fall off. The light is going to get less intense when it goes further away from the projector. And if you simulate the light fall off on top of that, that's going to probably be too much, well, depending on where the light comes from. So if you have a spotlight that comes from the same area as the projector is and points towards where the projector's light is falling, then you have to set this light fall off to constant. Otherwise, you're going to be duplicating the effect, and the light fall off is going to be too much. If you're using lights that go on a right angle to the projector's point or view, then the simulated light fall off is going to be good. There should maybe, I was thinking about scripting or something to make this always work, so that probably it would need to be a shader, I was thinking, but I haven't really got anywhere trying to do this, but it might be possible to actually create a light fall off that always works for these projections, where it takes into account the distance from the projector. So when you got all this, then actually you need content, of course. For us, it was the shadows of the dancers, and this we wanted to get as realistic as possible shadows. So we had the chance to get motion capturing done at Quantic Dreams studio in Paris, which was a really cool experience. They have this huge studio with like 50 or more cameras, and we had a great motion capture actress was our first time motion capture, and we were all really excited. This is, if you get a chance to see a motion capture actor, just take a picture of them with a flash on. It makes them look like a Christmas tree. It's really pretty fun. Well, yeah, that kind of worked really nicely, and I got from the studio. They retargeted the points onto this armature, and I've got an FBX, and I've converted this FBX with some conversion tool to Collada, and the Collada I could import nicely into Blender, and yeah, this is what I got. So I was really happy, and I went home and started to doing all this with all of these files, and started to apply the different files to the same armature, and turns out that the rest pose of the well. Thank you. So I had to kind of try and fix this. I started fixing this by rigging, actually. I imported another file, and I did a copy constraint for the bones in pose space, and got this. It's still not really nice, but it's already huge, much better than before. To correct the bone rolls, I kind of did this in-between rig thing, which had a duplication of every bone, and then I could adjust the bone rolls manually. I mean, it wasn't a perfect setup, but it worked, and it got the job done after maybe a couple of hours of tweaking all the bone rolls of all the animations. I had my animations done, and yeah, I was happy. That was great. So the next, actually, we only needed the shadows of all these animations. So we still needed some cloth. So I started to play around with cloth simulation, which works really nice in Blender. But I had a lot of trouble trying to get it the way I wanted it to look in the shadow also. I ended up with this simulation like this, where after doing cloth simulation, I use this great wireframe modifier, which is really nice. It really did a great job, because in the shadow of this, you can see the texture still of the cloth, which is just what I wanted. So that was that, and then the choreographer came to me again and said, well, the inspiration for all this is a classical ballet, and it's about these dancers are going to be ghosts of young girls who died of a broken heart, and they dance their victims to death in a forest. So they live in a forest, and the choreographer said, well, we want to do this show in a forest. So we had a lot of so we set up this little forest office kind of for about, well, the whole thing from setting up till actually with the shows and everything was 3 weeks, so maybe about 2 weeks of working in this forest office from 5 p.m. to 2 a.m. because we needed the dark for mapping the trees of the forest. It was actually it was the same thing again as in the square room. It was just a lot of cylinders, and I didn't measure too much. I just measured like the basics and then kind of estimated the rest. And you don't need to be too precise. The illusion is it will be just fine if you just estimate, and then if you can see the vertices on the projector in real time, then you can just move them a bit, and that works nicely. So after some here is a little piece of the final result. So you're gonna see this. hard to film this kind of stuff. So it was a mixture of projection. All the shadows, of course, were light from projectors, but there was also real light. There was about 70 neon tubes for the whole show. And so if you want to fool people to try and believe that your virtual light is real light, then the best thing to do is mix it with real light so that people cannot tell anymore which is the difference, which one is real, which one is projected. That's about it for this presentation. This was a whole cable mess in the thing. Yeah, that's it for this project. And I hope you found it interesting. The next thing I'm gonna try and do with projection is work with freestyle. So here's just some tests I'm working on at the moment with freestyle, trying to teach myself this awesome tool, and thanks a lot.
You can place your computer around there.